was to be considered my son. Well, this is part of the storyline, okay? The mom, of course, the story works out, right? Theseus grows up as a young man to be a stud. Well, and let's say this for our notes. These warriors, all of them, produce great things when they're young. It's what we call today prodigies. Prodigies. People, kids, who are able to do things that normal people just normally cannot do, right? Okay, and so Theseus is a prodigy. His mom will, of course, take him to the rock. He picks the rock up easily, he finds the sword, he finds the shoes, and then she tells him, now you gotta go find your dad. Okay? Theseus, however, right away says, well, I'm not gonna go find my dad on the ocean in a boat. That's safe. Instead, what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna take the unsafe route, I'm gonna go over the land, and I'm gonna have all kinds of adventures while I do it. In other words, let's put it in our notes this way. From a young age, this will sound very Miltonic, for those of you that know anything about John Milton at a young age, he says it, I am going to be a great adventurer, all right? I'm gonna be a hero, I wanna be a hero, and the only way to do that, obviously, is to gain a reputation, and the only way to do that is to have all kinds of contests, right? So that's what he's gonna do, okay? So off he goes. He's in many ways like his cousin Hercules. So let's put that in our notes. He's very much like Hercules' cousin, right? Who we're going to meet in the next chapter. Along the way, he kills all kinds of bad guys. And the point that Hamilton makes, I think, is worth our time here. I'll just read a few lines of this. He meets bad guys. He likes to kill them in the way they have inflicted pain. For example, his idea of dealing justice was simple but effective. What each had done to others, Theseus did to him. For example, Ceron, for instance, who had made those he captured kneel to wash his feet and then kick them down into the sea, Theseus hurled over a precipice. Sinus, who killed people by fastening them to two pine trees bent down to the ground and letting the trees go, died in that way himself. Procrustes was placed upon the iron bed, which he used for his victims, tying them to it, and then making them the right length for it by stretching those who were too short and cutting off as much as was necessary from those who were too long. The story does not say which of the two methods was used in his case, but there was not much to choose between them, and in one way or the other, Perseus' career ended. So in other words, let's just put it in our notes this way. Right away, Theseus is able to gain a reputation so that by the time he arrives in Athens, he's already got a pretty knockdown reputation as a hero. In Athens, his father is the actual king of Athens, and he's already got a problem. He's a little worried about this new young kid who's just shown up in Athens and thinks he's going to be a hero. Why? Because, of course, the king thinks this kid has a lot of power. He may try and take over my throne. We are at a banquet. Let's put it in our notes. We see this a lot in these stories where the hero is able to make some kind of a statement in a banquet. Think about what banquets are. Yes, you eat in a banquet, but it's also a party atmosphere. People are drinking, right? There's challenges which can be made, etc., etc. And so he shows up at this banquet, right? And it's interesting because his father is actually, because he doesn't know it's his son, he's actually ready to poison and kill him. And in fact, this poison will be given to him by, of all people, Medea. The same Medea who was in our Jason story of an earlier lecture. She got away, she comes to Athens, she kind of, befriends the king or is the lover of the king or whatever, and she says, I know a way to get rid of this guy, it's some poison. And the king is giving this to his son, who he doesn't know is his son, right? He doesn't know it's Theseus is his son. He's giving him the poisoned cup. Theseus is not interested in drinking, and he pulls out the sword. And the minute that he sees the sword, the king realizes it's my boy. And of course, Medea then has to hurry to get away because she didn't, without, you know, realizing she was going to help a king kill his own boy. Theseus then draws the sword, dad saves him, and Theseus immediately then is going to have his first major contest. Now let's get this one in our notes. In Crete, we have a famous sacrifice that has to be made by the Athenians. Okay? Young people will be sent to Crete because of an arrangement of a situation that had happened many years prior. And there's this nasty minotaur, this huge bull-like animal who lives in this labyrinth that Daedalus made. We talked about Daedalus in an earlier lecture. And Theseus says, I want to go as one of the sacrifices and I want to end up down there, and I want to be the one that kills the Minotaur. Now, for him to do that, he's going to need the help of the beautiful Ariadne. When he gets to Crete, the daughter of the king, Ariadne, sees Theseus. He's stunningly handsome, and by the way, let's point out, all of these heroes that we're talking about, physically stunning. They look like Abercrombie models, if you get my drift, all right? So when he shows up, immediately Ariadne says, oh, this is a man I need to help. And the way that she helps is fascinating as well. She says to Theseus, this is what Daedalus, who invented this labyrinth, this confusing maze, right? This is what he says. When you go in there, take a ball of thread with you, tie it to the door, and then just let the thread follow, and you'll be able to walk out using the thread. Well, it works, and Theseus is able to kill the Minotaur and able to get out, and then off he goes with Ariadne. Now, there's two stories here for your notes. There's two stories about what happens next. At the island of Naxos, he stops. Some stories say Theseus bolts from Ariadne and he leaves her, and she dies of a broken heart. The other says that she's seasick. This is maybe a little bit nicer story for Theseus, that she's seasick, and he sets into port, and then his boat gets pushed out to the ocean, and by the time he gets back, she has died. Either way, tragically, he loses his girl Ariadne. Okay. Meanwhile, there has been an agreement that when Theseus is coming back, if things have gone badly, there will be a black sail on the ship that will tell the father bad news. If there is a white sail on the ship, good news, and the father will know that his son Theseus is okay. Because of the situation with Ariadne, Theseus has forgotten to change the color of the sails. It is still the black sail, even though, right, he is alive. And when Aegis sees his son is dead, or who he thinks, right, his son is dead, he sees the black sail, he jumps from the cliffs into the ocean, and he commits suicide in sorrow. And from this point on, Hamilton will tell us, the ocean around Athens and Greece, we will call, because the name of the father is Aegis, we will call it the Aegean Sea. So let's write that down. So we have a famous name, the Aegean Sea will be named because Aegis is going to commit suicide. And he jumps, right? Theseus then becomes the king of Athens. But interestingly, and for your notes, he does not want to rule over Athens the way most normal kings do. This is what makes Theseus such an important hero for the Athenian people. Rather, he forms a commonwealth where people have power. This is our first kind of notion of a democratic kind of understanding of politics. The only thing he wants to be is commander-in-chief so he can go out and have more fights and jack things, right? Because of this, for your notes, Athens becomes one of the most famously happy cities. The Athenians love this story, right? Theseus then goes on. He will engage in a defeat of Thebes, but he will say there will be no looting. In other words, let's put it in our notes this way. Theseus is a winner, but he's a good winner. He doesn't rub people's noses in it, we might say. Also, interestingly, there at Thebes, he hooks up and is with Oedipus, the great hero that we'll talk about in a different lecture. Oedipus, and in fact, he's there when Oedipus dies. A little bit later, Theseus, in a story we'll have more to say about in a bit, he befriends Hercules, who he's related to, and when Hercules tragically, because in a fit of rage, Hercules does this, kills his wife and his sons, it's Theseus who actually will invite him back to Athens and will say, it's okay, Hercules, don't commit suicide in shame, come back, and we're going to help you. In other words, Theseus is a man who wants to believe in forgiveness. So let's write that one down as well. Theseus is that kind of hero as well. He still loves danger for danger's sake. He attacks the Amazons, for example. He loves Hippolyta, and through his relationship with Hippolyta, he produces a son, Hippolytus. And of course, Hippolytus becomes very famous in his own right. Other adventures, he ends up in some stories on the Argo with Jason and the Argonauts. He has a friend. This is an interesting story for Theseus. Pirithous. Pirithous, he is kind of an interesting cat in his own right. Pirithous, he knows about Theseus. He says, you know what, I'm going to show that I'm a better hero than Theseus. And the way he does it is by stealing Theseus's cattle, right? And then when Theseus runs him down, and Pirithous realizes that Theseus is this amazing hero, he says to him, dude, I just wanted to see what kind of warrior you were, so this is what I'll do. I will surrender to you. You do with me what you want. And the minute that Theseus says that, he goes, well, you're an interesting guy. They end up becoming best friends. Let's put it in our notes this way. In mythology, we often see this as a case where enemies become the closest of friends. Theseus will help to kill the centaurs at Pirithous' wedding. And then it's interesting. Pirithous, he decides, his wife has since died. He decides he wants a new wife, and the wife that he wants is Persephone from the underworld. Of course, we know the story of Persephone and Demeter from an earlier lecture. Hades took Persephone down into the underworld for 6 months out of the year. She lives in the underworld, which is why nothing grows on in the earth, and that's, of course, why we have winter. Persephone is the wife of Hades, and Theseus decides, all right, I will help you to go down into the underworld and to steal Persephone, which is, of course, an insane thing to try to attempt to do. Meanwhile, Theseus himself wants a girl, and so he decides to kidnap Helen. Helen, of course, the queen of Sparta, but now she's just a young girl. He knows that she's going to grow up to be the most beautiful woman in the world, and so he steals her. But Helen's saved by her two brothers, Castor and Pollux, and so, of course, that allows for the story of the fall of Troy and all of that that we will get to in our Troy tale later. In Hades, they sneak down into Hades. In Hades, they meet Hades. In the underworld, they meet the king of the underworld, Hades, and he says, hey, listen, why don't you come and sit in this special chair that I have here? It's called, for your notes, the chair of forgetfulness. And what it is, what it does is when you sit in the chair, you completely forget everything that happened in your prior life, and you kind of sit there zombie-like. You're not dead, but you're kind of zombie-like. Theseus ultimately will, though, be released by his cousin Hercules in one of those famous stories we'll get to in a little bit about Hercules. Later in life, Theseus will marry Ariadne's sister Phaedra, and we have a famous story about Phaedra, so let's tell that one really quickly. Phaedra will fall in love with Theseus's son, Hippolytus, who ironically hates women. He's got no interest in being with any girl. He loves to go out, he loves to go hunting, he loves to go fishing, he loves to go four-wheeling. I mean, that's what Hippolytus likes to do. He's got no interest in women. Phaedra is in love with him, and she begs him to have an affair with her. And Hippolytus will say, no. She does the unthinkable. She kills herself. She leaves a letter saying that Hippolytus did it. And when Theseus opens the letter, he believes what Phaedra has said. He banishes his son, Hippolytus, who goes off and rides his chariot down by the ocean. A monster comes out of the ocean. He wrecks his chariot, and Hippolytus will, in fact, be mortally wounded. Meanwhile, Artemis comes to Theseus and tells him the truth. And in the very end of our story, tragically, Theseus has to live with the fact that he sent his son into exile and ultimately to his own death, but he didn't understand, he didn't know why. Finally, the end of Theseus, there's an interesting story here that he's killed by King Lycodemus, it's in an island where actually Achilles hangs out as a woman, dressed up as a woman, because Achilles has been told by his mother, you will not be allowed to go to fight at that walls of Troy because you'll end up dying. It's in a story that we'll get to in the next lecture. Athens, let's finish now. Athens loves Theseus as the defender of the defenseless, as a warrior who uses his head, his mind, and not just his brawn and his toughness. Okay, let's finish our annotations at 2a. Well, let's think about this one. Great men even can be ruined through deceit. That's one of the major themes here. You can come up with your own. At 2b, the symbol. Well, I would say there's a couple of them. Think about that chair of forgetfulness, right? Our ability to kind of forget the things that maybe matter most to us in our life. Think about that black sail versus the white sail. What kind of symbol is that, right? And of course, the fact that you might be mistaken. The father thinks that his son is dead when in fact the son is not dead at all. At 3a, other texts, we can throw out any number of ones. How about Shakespeare's Othello, right? Of course, Othello is completely destroyed because Iago will fool him with that handkerchief, right? And finally, at 3b, what was a time that you were mistaken, kind of like that black sail, white sail thing? What was a time for you when you thought you understood something and you didn't at all? You were kind of fooled or mistaken. All right, let's move on. Chapter 11, we now come to the greatest, maybe, of all-time heroes, Hercules. Let's talk about him for a moment. Now, to be clear, Hercules is the most famous hero of the Greeks. Theseus is the most famous hero of the Athenians, who are, of course, themselves Greeks. But they like Theseus more than Hercules. Why? Well, because Athens prides itself as a city that enjoys thought and the use of the mind. Of course, Theseus is a man who uses his head and not just his brawn, right? We're going to make this distinction, put it in your notes now. We're going to make this distinction later when we draw distinctions, comparisons between Achilles and Odysseus. Achilles is a guy like Hercules that just wants to jack things. Odysseus is a different kind of hero. He uses his mind, right? Well, what are we going to say about Hercules? Well, first and foremost, we're going to say that he has tremendous strength, tremendous courage, and when you put those two things together, he has got unbelievable confidence. He thinks he can win any battle, right? For example, he goes down to Apollo's oracle, and he wants to know the future. The oracle says, "I won't tell you." He picks up the sacred tripod, and he's ready to jack it. He's ready to go fight against Apollo himself. Zeus is like, whoa, wait. Right? We should point out, Hercules is known for not being very intelligent. Okay, let's write this one down. He's very emotional, but not very intelligent, right? For example, in the story about Jason and the Argonauts, right about the time they need him the most, he runs off because his friend Hylas has abandoned the group, and so he just leaves. And just runs away to go find Hylas, right? He has terrible outbursts of rage. Let's put this in our notes. Hercules as a character in Greek mythology is a guy who can get so mad that he does the unthinkable. We'll get to it in a little bit, but the unthinkable for Hercules will be, in a fit of rage, he kills his wife and his three sons. And then he wakes up out of his rage and he realizes what he's done. He's so upset, he kills them and doesn't even realize that he's done it. That's what we mean by these emotional outbursts. If you know somebody who gets so mad, so upset, that they do something really crazy, and they just kind of lose their mind, it's like a fit of insanity, that's very Herculean. But the Greeks love this about Hercules. Not that he kills his wife and his three sons in a moment of rage, but rather after the fact, he is willing to say, "I'm really sorry." And he's willing to go through, like, for example, all kinds of punishments. He's willing to suffer for his misdeeds. Let's put that in our notes that way. He's willing to suffer for his misdeeds. He takes it gracefully. He knows he did something really terrible when he lost his temper. But he just can't help himself from losing his temper. And several times in our stories, Hercules will do this kind of thing where he jacks somebody. And a lot of times they're totally innocent people. And he jacks them and he doesn't even mean to. It's kind of accidental or it's his rage or whatever. All right, let's talk about Hercules. Well, his father is Zeus. His mother, Alcmaeon, is a mortal woman, and this makes Zeus's wife, Hera, extremely mad. She wants to kill Hercules, right? And this, by the way, is how Disney got this wrong. For those of you that love the Disney film Hercules, Hercules does not have Zeus and Hera as his mother and father. That would make no sense because that would make Hercules a god. And while in the end Hercules ends up a god, he is actually part god, part human. And it's that part human part that Zeus's wife Hera loathes. So she's going to spend the whole life of Hercules tormenting Hercules for the fact that Hera's husband Zeus slept with a mortal woman, right? Hercules does have a brother, Iphicles, but Iphicles is not as strong. And we have a famous story. Snakes come in at the first year of birth, and they are going to bite and kill Hercules and his brother. His brother cries in horror and fear. Hercules, however, grabs the two serpents and, you know, kind of strangles the life out of the snakes. And when mom and dad show up, there is the young baby Hercules sitting in the crib holding these two huge snakes that he's killed. And it's at that point that everyone kind of starts to go, hey, this kid's going to be famous. Tiresias says, the famous blind prophet, that he will be the hero of all mankind. And of course, he ends up doing that. Hercules, hard to educate. What do you mean hard to educate? Well, let me give you an example. In Greek schools, you learn to play music, the flute. Hercules is being taught by this guy. The guy must have said something to him. Hercules grabs his flute, hits the guy on the head with the flute, brains him and kills him. So this gives you an example of the rage from the very early years. For those of you that know any stories about Alexander the Great when he was young, he was educated for a brief period of time by the great philosopher Aristotle. And Aristotle said, I can't educate this kid. All he ever wants to do is ride ponies and go hunting and fishing. He won't sit still to actually learn. Probably today we would say about a kid like Alexander and, of course, Hercules, that they are incapable of enduring school. So if you know somebody, for example, who just loathes the whole idea of school, there it is, right? At 18, he kills the Thespian lion, and from there on, he wears the lion's skin as a cloak with the head of the lion as kind of a hat. So let's put that in our notes. If you see Hercules often in any kind of drawing, you'll often see him represented this way. Well, there's a number of stories here. He conquers the Minyans, he marries Megara, and he has three sons with Megara. But then in a fit of rage, he kills all four of them, right? And immediately,